skimp on John, because John 6. I'm just going to move along quickly. Okay. So, the next objection. Jesus was speaking symbolically when he said, I am the bread of life. And Jesus also said that he was the gate and the vine. Should we also be worshiping gates and vines? Now, the background of this objection is that Jesus gives seven I am sayings. Anytime Jesus says, I am, what does that remind you of? I am. Where have you heard that?
Yahweh.
Okay. So it's the name that's revealed to Moses at the burning bush. Okay. So that term I am speaks of his divinity, not of his humanity. Now, the seven I am sayings, he says, I am the vine, I am the gate or the door, the way, the truth, and the life, the resurrection of life, the good shepherd, the bread of life, and the light of the world. The context of John 6, which you have in front of you, is the Passover. You don't have it on that handout because the chapter is so long, I didn't photocopy. All right? I just photocopied this when I moved on. But John chapter 6, I believe it's verse 4, actually says the Passover of the Jews was at hand. So what's the miracle that he's performing in John 6 but the multiplication of loaves? Right? Loaves and fish. So the context tells you that the author wants you to interpret what's going to happen next in terms of the Passover. All right? So, but since Passover is typologically about Christ as the new lamb, then we already know that the Israelites had to eat the flesh of the lamb in order to fulfill the Passover prescriptions. There is no logical parallel between the words, this is my body, and I am the vine, or I am the door. The image of the vine and the door can have, of their very nature, a symbolic sense. Christ is like a vine because all the sap of my spiritual life comes from him. He's like a door because I go to heaven through him. But a piece of bread is in no way like his flesh. Of its very nature, it cannot symbolize the actual body of Christ. Jesus himself excludes a symbolical interpretation when he says, the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world, and my flesh is meat indeed. All right? So he's using that food analogy. This, that is, it is to be actually eaten, not merely commemorated in a symbolical way. The next objection, if you look at your John chapter 6, look at verse 63. It says, the flesh is of no avail. Let's have someone read John chapter 6, verses 51. Get to the New Testament here. Could someone read verses 51 through 59? Could someone read that?
I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. The Jews quarreled among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, amen, amen, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you do not have life within you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and will raise him on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood true drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me and I have life because of the Father, so also the one who feeds on me will have life because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Unlike your ancestors who ate and still died, whoever eats this bread will live forever. These things he said while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum.
Thank you. Okay, so you have this constant repetition in this section about consuming his flesh. All right. Now, the word flesh in Greek is the word sarx, S-A-R-X. Okay. Now, those who deny the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist will then point to verse 63, where it says, "It is the Spirit that gives life, while the flesh is of no avail." Now, does that make sense? Where Jesus would constantly be speaking about consuming his flesh and then say the flesh is of no avail. There seems to be a contradiction there. Let's just look at verse 63 there for a second, where it speaks about both the Spirit. It says the Spirit gives life while the flesh is of no avail. So there's a contrast between the Spirit's ability to enlighten our minds and human reason's ability to comprehend revealed truths apart from faith. So it is the earthbound perspective that is profitless. Now, if you do what I have up here, and I'm sorry that it turned out so small, but what I did was, one of the things that biblical scholars do is we look at words and we count them, first of all, and then we see what kind of context they occur. So if you look at the word flesh in John's gospel, you'll see that it occurs 13 times, right? And it either refers to human flesh or divine flesh. Every time it refers to human flesh, it's used in the phrase the flesh. There's only one time that it refers to divine flesh where it says the flesh, and that is in verse
63.
No.
Oh, sorry.
53. It says, unless you eat the flesh, but then it says, of the Son of Man, and drink his blood, you have no life in you. So you have this contrast between human flesh, which is always designated as the flesh, as opposed to my flesh, or the very first time that it appears in John's gospel, it says, and the Word became flesh. And that's clearly a reference to his divinity, right? So this contrast between the flesh, which is purely human, and my flesh, which is clearly divine, right? So six times here I have it on the left-hand side, it appears as the flesh, and then seven times it refers to his divinity. Now, in the verses that were just read, in verses 54 through 58, what is especially noteworthy is that what you don't pick up in the English, what they're really saying in the Greek, there is a constant reference to the flesh, and or just using the word flesh, and about eating the flesh. But there's two different words that are used for eating. There's the normal word that's used for eating right up until verse 54, I believe it is. And that word is phaging, okay? The normal word for humans eating. But then all of a sudden, from verses 54 through 58, John no longer uses the word for humans eating, but he uses the word trogain, which is like Rogaine, but with a T in front of it. So we can say that, you know, those of us who don't have hair, we can make reference to Rogaine.
But for yourself.
That's right. So he uses the word trogain instead of phagain. Now that word is important because it's the word that's normally used for animals sinking their teeth into the meat and ripping it apart.
Gnawing.
That's right. Munching on something. Okay. So literally, the word is to sink one's teeth into. So the word trogain, of course, only occurs one other place in the New Testament. It's in Matthew, but that's not as important. And then let's read verses 60 through 69, someone, for extra credit.
Then many of his disciples who were listening said, this saying is hard. Who can accept it? Since Jesus knew that his disciples were murmuring about this, he said to them, does this shock you? What if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? Is it the Spirit that gives life, while the flesh is of no avail? The word I have spoken to you are spirit and life, but there are some of you who do not believe. Jesus knew from the beginning the ones who would not believe and the ones who would betray him, and the one who would betray him. And he said, for this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless is granted by him, granted him by my Father. As a result of this, many of his disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer accompanied Jesus. Jesus said to the 12, do you want to leave? Simon Peter answered him, Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God.
Okay, thank you. So I want to draw your attention to verse 66 there, where it says, as a result of this, many of his disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer accompanied him. So his disciples draw back. And this is the only instance in the Gospels where Jesus loses followers in such large numbers, right? That's plain to see. That's the word that's very clear that he loses a large number of followers. But notice Jesus' response. His response is not to explain his words as symbolic. The Gospels themselves are very clear that when the disciples are confused, Jesus will explain to them what he really means. He often does that with the parables. So if you're looking for an example, Mark chapter 4, verse 34, where it says, he did not speak to them without parable, but privately he explained everything to his disciples. So when there's confusion or something that needs to be clarified, he explains it. But here in John 6, he doesn't explain anything. In fact, he never says that he is speaking symbolically. Instead, he doubles down and says to his disciples in verse 67, will you leave me too? Right? So basically, here's your opportunity to leave if you cannot accept these words.